The gods were astronauts. Evidence of the True Identities of the Old Gods by Erich von Daniken. Narrated by Kevin Foley. Copyright 2001 by Erich von Daniken. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with the John W. White Literary Agency and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. Keep listening after The Gods Were Astronauts for a bonus interview with author Erich von Daniken. Publisher's note: this audiobook is packaged with bonus material which has been included on each audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please refer to www.tantor.com, keyword The Gods Were Astronauts, to access these images. Foreword. It was some 55 years ago, and it happened in the primary school of the town of Schaffhausen in Switzerland. I was about 10 years old and listened to our religious instructor telling us that once a battle had taken place in heaven. One day the archangel Lucifer had appeared before the throne of God with his legion of angels and had declared, "We are not going to serve you anymore." At which point the Almighty God had ordered the archangel Michael to chuck Lucifer out of heaven along with all his rebellious followers. Michael duly carried out this command with his flaming sword. From that day, according to our RE teacher, Lucifer had become the devil, and all his followers were burning in hell. That evening, for the first time in my young life, I was really pensive. We children had been told that heaven was a place of absolute bliss, a place where all the good people went after they died, a place, too, where all souls became intimately one with God. How could conflict occur in such paradisiacal realms, where absolute joy ruled, where oneness with God was perfect? There could be no opposition, no quarrel. Why, oh why, should Lucifer and all his angels suddenly rebel against an almighty, all-loving God? My mother, whom I asked for an explanation, was unable to help. With God, she said, wearing a troubled expression, everything was possible. That's how it had to be, even the impossible. Later, at high school, where we were taught Latin, I understood that the name Lucifer was formed out of the two words, lux, light, and fer, to do, to carry. Lucifer really means light-maker, or bringer of light. Of all creatures, was the devil supposed to be the bringer of light? My realization, based on the Latin, made the whole business even more bewildering. 20 years later, I had thoroughly studied the Old Testament, as Christians call the ancient traditions. There, I read passages from the Jewish prophet Isaiah, circa 740 B.C. "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God, I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation." Isaiah 14, verses 12 through 13. These verses from Isaiah may have been altered during the course of the millennia. But what might he have been thinking about originally? In the so-called Revelation of John, author of the prophecy of the Apocalypse, one can read another clear and definite allusion to battles in heaven in chapter 12, verse 7. "And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought, and his angels, and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven." Curious. The great traditions of other peoples, too, support the idea that these battles in heaven were not entirely made up. In the Egyptian Book of the Dead, a collection of texts that were placed in a grave with a mummified body so the deceased would know how to behave in the beyond, we read how Ra, the mighty sun god, fought against the rebellious children of heaven. The god Ra, we read, never left his egg during the entire battle. Battles in heaven? In outer space? Or did our ignorant forefathers merely mean the battles between good and evil that are fought within humans? Did they perhaps imagine the atmospheric battle during a thunderstorm and project it onto a battle in outer space? a battle of dark clouds against the sun? Or did the origin of this bewildering thinking lie in a solar eclipse, where something terrible was trying to eat up the sun? All these natural explanations do not really take us any further, as I will demonstrate. If the battle between Lucifer and Michael were only to be found in the ancient Jewish sphere, one could easily gloss over it. But it is not the only example, and very old stories only too often show up astonishing similarities. For thousands of years, Tibetan monasteries preserved texts called Dzogchen. Some original text, which may or may not still exist, must have been the source of the many Dzogchen fragments that have turned up in Indian temple libraries. We are talking of hundreds of sheets written in Sanskrit, sandwiched between two pieces of wood. There, one can read that in the Fourth World Age, the sons were ordered to create likenesses of themselves. A third of the sons refused to carry out the command. The older wheels turned down and up. The spawn of the mother filled the all. Battles were fought between the creators and the destroyers, and battles about space. Do your calculations, Lanu, if you wish to obtain the true age of your wheel. I discussed parts of Greek mythology in my last book. Greek mythology also begins with a battle in heaven. The children of Uranus rebelled against the heavenly order and the creator. Terrible battles ensued, and the Zeus, the father of the gods, is only one of the victors. Prometheus was one of those who fought against Zeus, and this took place in heaven, as Prometheus was the one who stole the fire from heaven and brought it down to earth. Prometheus, Lucifer, the bringer of light? On the other side of the world, far from Greece, lies New Zealand. Even 100 years ago, ethnologist John White was asking the old priests of the Maori about their legends. Their legends, too, begin with a battle in heaven. Some of the sons of God rebelled against their father. The leader of these space warriors was called Rongame, and after a victorious battle, he allowed himself to be feted on Earth. His appearance was like a brilliant star, like a flame, like a sun. Wherever he landed, the earth was churned up. Dust clouds obscured one's view. The noise sounded like thunder and, from a distance, like the rushing sound inside a seashell. These accounts cannot just be disposed of by shoving them into the psychologist's bag. A very ancient memory has been preserved here. In the Drona Parva, the oldest Indian tradition, the battles in space are described in the same manner as in old Jewish legends that are not part of the Old Testament. There, too, there is mention of holy wheels in which the cherubim reside. This is, of course, not just anywhere, but in heaven and among the stars. Etymologists assure us that no one should see all this symbolically. These strange stories are only myths. Only? Which family tree should we climb up, then, if all that is to be found in mythology are symbols? And if they are symbols, what do the symbols stand for? The term symbol comes from the Greek symbolion and means to throw together. If myths are only to be perceived symbolically, I would really like to know what exactly has been thrown together. An attempt to side with the vagueness of myths will not take us one step further. We have become a society that simply accepts and believes the most contradictory traditions, believing in the way religions would have us believe. But evidently, we are not prepared to accept a few facts. When I maintain that the Holy Book, and the first books of the Old Testament in particular, bristle with contradictions and horror stories, and that the God who spoke to Moses could never be looked upon as the true God of creation, people become offended and indignantly demand proof. When I present the evidence, I get publicly clobbered for my pains. Why? Because we are not supposed to question beliefs and faith. Of course, that only applies to the beliefs of the larger religious groups. If I attack the beliefs of a smaller group, the rule no longer applies. Mankind has arrived in a new millennium. For myself, I think it is more responsible to analyze the old stories and target new goals. Chapter 1. A Different Kind of RE Lesson. Science is the only remedy against superstition. Henry T. Buckle. There is no arguing about the fact that human beings doubt and even despair of God. Everyone is familiar with the question, how could God let it happen? It might refer to the millions of maltreated and murdered Jews in the Second World War, or to the torture victims of all dictatorships. How could God allow innocent children to be tortured and killed? How can He permit natural catastrophes that bring starvation and suffering to so many peoples? How could He allow Christians to be persecuted in His name, allow humans to be slaughtered in dreadful ways, allow Christian zealots to put other Christians, witches, or those allegedly possessed by the devil to death by unimaginable, atrocious methods of torture? The list of questions about how God could have allowed all these things is endless, and the answers, which we swallow along with the incomprehensible, are always the same. God has, so we are talked into believing, reserved a special place in heaven for those maltreated victims. There, in that kingdom beyond, they will be well rewarded. God's counsel is incomprehensible but wise. Man thinks, but God guides. We should not pose questions about the why, credulous theologians assure us. God alone knows why. Maybe. But this same God, so the Christian, Jewish, and Muslim tradition goes, is supposed to have created us in His own image. We read this in Genesis, and it is valid for the three great world religions. And God said, "Let us make man in our own image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth." So God created man in His own image. In the image of God, He created him. Male and female created He them. Genesis 1, verses 26 through 27. If man is the image or likeness of God, he should also be intelligent. And no one could dispute that what we understand as God must be the highest of all imaginable intelligences. Intelligent life forms just happen to have the habit of asking questions and searching for answers. Intelligent beings do not believe in any old nonsense. And if we are not in God's image, we are still left with the fact that we are intelligent beings, either with or without God's image. Here, by intelligence, I mean culture in the widest possible sense, something that separates us from animals. And there is another thing. God should not only be the power of intelligence to the highest degree, but naturally infallible as well. But the God we meet in the Old Testament is not infallible. After God has created man and woman, He saw it was very good. Genesis 1, verse 31. That is what one would expect from divine work. But this same Lord, who created man, shortly afterwards regrets what He has done. And it repented the Lord that He had made man on the earth, and it grieved Him at His heart. And the Lord said, "I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping thing, and the fowls of the air, for it repenteth me that I have made them." Genesis 6, verse 6. Incomprehensible! First, this infallible God creates animals and man, discovers that it is good, and then He repents of His deed. This is divine? A further characteristic that has to be attributed to God is timelessness. A true God must stand outside time. He would never have to try out experiments and then wait to see how they turn out. But this is exactly what happens in the Old Testament, several times. After God had created man, He set them down in the Garden of Eden. There, Adam and Eve were allowed to do anything they liked except for one thing. They were not allowed to eat the apple. It is beside the point whether the apple stands as a symbol for something else, whether for sin or the first sexual act. A prohibition exists. This timeless God should have known from the start that His creations would circumvent this prohibition, which is exactly what happens whereupon the deeply offended God chases our first ancestors out of paradise. The Christian Church has even managed to top this with further illogical concepts. All the descendants of Adam and Eve are saddled with an ominous original sin that can only be paid off by the blood sacrifice of God's only Son. A truly dreadful thought. I am, and I repeat this in each of my books, a believer in God and a God-fearing person. I pray, too, every day. My poor brain is not capable of defining God. Many cleverer people than I have tried to. And still, for me, God is something quite extraordinary and certainly unique. I am in agreement with the great world religions. There can only be one God, and that which we call God must be infallible, timeless, omnipresent, and omnipotent. Those are the very least characteristics we have to concede to God with deep respect. It will never be possible to describe God or to nail down the Holy Spirit anywhere on a timeline. Science tells us at the beginning hydrogen was all there was, or the Big Bang. And what caused the Big Bang? What was before the Big Bang? This Big Bang, the super clever astrophysicists tell us, happened about 15,000 million years ago and lasted a fraction of a second. But we are unable to explain that fraction of a second. Nothing arises from nothing. Even the most intricate mathematical formulas will not overcome that obstacle. Albert Einstein, 1879 through 1955, in addition to the theory of relativity, also formulated the lesser-known theory of gravitation. Both explain the macrocosm, our greater universe, so to speak. Then along came another genius from the field of physics, Werner Heisenberg, 1901 through 1976, and developed formulas of quantum physics, which to this day can only be understood by specialists. The behavior of the microcosm can be explained with the help of quantum physics. What is going on behind those subatomic particles? To be exact, both concepts, the gravitation theory and quantum physics, should meet in the Big Bang theory. But the mathematical theories that attempt to connect the two concepts turn out to be just absurd numbers and formulas that do not make sense. Nothing seems to fit together. A plausible theory that would presumably be called quantum gravitation does not exist. The breeding chamber of the universe has remained locked. Space and time, which supposedly did not exist before the Big Bang, came into being at the same time as the Big Bang. But what did exist before space and time began to be? Space and time came into being simultaneously, as our needle-sharp analytical astrophysicists' minds have discovered. Innumerable calculations were carried out and computers fed with data to arrive at this epoch-making realization. International conferences were organized and deeply meaningful papers were read. Scientists could have arrived at the answer much more easily. Plato's Timaeus dialogue, written about 2,500 years ago, tells us, "So time then came into being with the heavens in order that, having come into being together, they should also be dissolved together, if ever they are dissolved." If we start with the question, "What is God?" we could equally well ask, "Who or what created God?" There is no end, or better, no beginning. Human beings made a father figure out of God, a person who commands and punishes, praises and criticizes. This is certainly not what creation is about. Theologians argue that we should grant this creator being the ability to be able to transform into a person at any moment and to take on human form. That may well be. But even then, this God person should retain its divine attributes. Naturally, I am familiar with concepts of God from different religions and philosophical schools, and in the end, they all boil down to the same thing. Whatever God is, it should be eternal, timeless, perfect, and omnipresent. It was Albert Einstein who coined the phrase, "God does not play dice." The one in the Old Testament did. And in several demonstrable cases, he did not foresee the future, as can be seen, for example, with regard to the prophet Ezra, Hebrew, succor. Ezra was one of the few prophets who returned to Jerusalem around 458 BC, after the Babylonian captivity. In the Old Testament, there is just one chapter about Ezra, but the apocryphal texts contain much more about him. There we find Ezra asking God, or his emissaries, about the signs that would come, and about his own life. The answer was as follows. I can only tell you about some of the signs you ask about. I am not able to tell you anything about your future life, as I do not know myself. Now, Ezra does not belong in the same period as Moses, and it may be that he was having his conversations with somebody else, only not with God. But the God of Adam and Eve's times did not seem to know what was going on either. After Eve had served up the apple to her husband, he hid himself in the bushes out of fear. But God does not seem to know where Adam is. And the Lord God called unto Adam, and said unto him, Where art thou? Genesis 3, verse 9. Adam assures the Lord that he has heard him, but had hidden himself because he was ashamed. Then the Lord wants to know who had told Adam he was naked, and asks whether he has eaten of the tree that was forbidden. Adam replies, The woman who thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat. Genesis 3, verse 12. According to this version, God was definitely not in the picture. He did not know where Adam was, and had no idea that Eve had tempted him to eat the apple. People who believe the Bible say that such passages should not be taken literally. Everything should be seen symbolically. Well, all right then, but even the symbolic illogic does not make sense, as we shall see. After Adam works out how to have sex, Eve bears her sons, Cain and Abel. Abel becomes a shepherd, and Cain becomes an arable farmer. Two crisis-proof, subsidized professions. The two boys bring sacrifices before the Lord. And what does this infallible God do? He acknowledges Abel and his sacrifice with a well-pleased eye, but does not acknowledge Cain and his sacrifice. Genesis 4, verses 4 through 5. Up to this point, neither Cain nor Abel had any experience of double standards. No wonder Cain reacted in a disgruntled way to this partisan God. And the Lord said unto Cain, Why art thou wroth, and why is thy countenance fallen? Genesis 4, verse 6. An all-knowing God should have known. But this one does not even prevent Cain from killing his innocent brother Abel. He even has to ask, And the Lord said unto Cain, Where is Abel thy brother? And he says, I know not. Am I my brother's keeper? Genesis 4, verse 9. Although God ends up punishing Cain, the latter is still destined to become the progenitor of a phenomenally large lineage that was to make biblical history. But Cain is not the only murderer in God's eyes, as the much later Moses carries the same stigma. I will come back to Moses later. The biblical narrative begins to turn decidedly dramatic in chapter 6. And it came to pass, when men began to multiply on the face of the earth, and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were fair, and they took wives of all which they chose. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that, when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men which were of old, men of renown. Genesis 6, verse 4. I shall not discuss those giants anymore, as I have already done so in my previous book. The question of those sons of God has also come up before. I just do not comprehend how those who believe in the Bible, and who usually quote all manner of passages from the Holy Book, always seem to ignore these crucial passages. Yet it is quite clear that what is spoken of is the sons of God. I can nowadays only manage a weary smile in the face of the scholarly battles that have raged for centuries around these words and resulted in thousands of contradictory comments. Here, the term sons of God has been translated as fallen angels, There, they have been interpreted as renegade spirit beings or as guardians of the heavens. It's enough to make one tear out one's hair. Three little words have twisted faith into its opposite. The experts who are able to read Hebrew, however, know exactly what these three words are referring to, those who descended from above. In the end, this conflict among theologians about the meaning of the term sons of God is irrelevant. Whether they are interpreted as rebel angels or guardians of heaven, God should have known beforehand what they were up to. Evidently, he had no idea. And those who would like to make spirit beings out of these sons of God should read on in the Holy Book. These spirit beings have sex with humans. Spirits do not do this. Confusion reigns supreme in the book of Genesis. The thing that saddens me is that millions of people believe that this contradictory God spoken of in Genesis is identical with the grandiose spirit who created the universe. And this is not just in popular belief. No, even in theological specialist literature, which twists and justifies every contradiction with unbelievable sophistry, the God of the Old Testament is seen as the universal, only God with all the divine attributes. Famous Jesuit and professor of theology Karl Rahner, who teaches whole hosts of young priests, assures us that the story of the Old Testament originates from the God who, in the end, revealed himself in Jesus Christ. The text of the Old and New Testaments, according to Rahner, all have the same source. God has made a special covenant with the people of Israel, which from time immemorial has, however, been planned as a mere prologue to the coming of Christ. Oh, and the Old Testament was planned right from the beginning as an open movement steered by God towards final salvation. The very inventive and wordy theology professors do concede that the Old Testament has been cobbled together out of diverse texts that originate from different times and by various authors. Patriarchal reports originating from the dim and distant past had been collected together. They even admit to artistic license from various theological schools, all according to the needs of their time. For example, there is the insinuation that the histories of Israel, such as those of the Yavists or those of the descendants of King David, were only aimed at legitimizing Solomon's throne or the takeover of Palestine by Israel. In the face of such claims, there is no need to be surprised that Jews and Christians find it so hard to get on. In spite of all these concessions and twists of interpretation, a kind of abstruse, know-all attitude prevails in theological circles, which maintains that the historical narratives in the Bible are, without exception, reports of the consummation of the Word of God. This formula is universally applicable. The latter statement is according to theology professor Jacques Guillet. So, how is this supposed to look? The Old Testament is supposed to be a movement directed by God towards ultimate salvation. Rahner. This plan is universally applicable. Guillet. And so that there may be no doubts at all, the story of the Old Testament and the New Testament originate from a single God who revealed himself in Christ, so that the text of the Old and New Testaments should have the same source. Rahner. At the same time, many of the patriarchal reports are supposed to have originated in the dim and distant past, and still be, without exception, reports of the consummation of God's Word. The only remedy for this highbrow theological nonsense is probably education. One should not presume to tell me what I should be seeing. I am able to read. The story of the deluge and Noah's Ark is generally well known, and I have dealt with it in previous books. For those of you who are new to my books, I will merely repeat, what you read about the deluge in Genesis chapter 6, verse 9, originates from much older Babylonian and even Sumerian texts. Somebody in the distant past has, therefore, inserted a story into the book of books, the Holy Writ, and also invented the name Noah. And all of this originates from completely different sources. And still, according to theology, the Old Testament deals, without exception, with reports of the consummation of the Word of God, Jacques Guillet. After the Great Flood and when the Ark landed on top of a mountain, Noah made a sacrifice to the Lord, and according to Genesis chapter 8, verse 21, and the Lord smelled a sweet savor. This is not very different from what happens in the Epic of Gilgamesh. Utnapishtim, who has survived the flood, sacrifices a lamb, grain, cedar wood, and myrtle on the mountain. The gods smelled the odor, and the odor rose pleasantly to the nostrils of the gods, and the gods assembled like flies around the sacrifice. Strange gods who are able to smell frying meat. After this pleasant odor of cooked meat, the God of the Old Testament decides that he will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake. Genesis 8, verse 21. And also, neither will I again smite any more every living thing as I have done. He invites Noah and his sons to be fruitful and to multiply and replenish the earth. God also states clearly that all animals should be subject to man. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl of the air, and all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hands are they delivered. Genesis 9, verse 2. Animal lovers will probably never be able to follow comfortably this divine command. In the older parallel story from the Epic of Gilgamesh, there are several gods who smell the frying meat and gather above the ark. The gods begin to squabble with each other and harangue the god Enlil who caused the flood. O wisest of gods, O great warrior hero, how could you, taking no counsel, bring on the deluge? In the end, the god of the earth and all lands climbs into the ship, leads Utnapishtim together with his wife out of the ark, lays his hand on them, and blesses them. An additional flood story with a similar content is described in the Enuma Elish from the Babylonian tutelary poem of the creation. Whoever it was who was identified as God in these sources, he was definitely not the creator of the universe. The Old Testament and the Epic of Gilgamesh describe the same events, however, with the decided difference that in the Epic of Gilgamesh, an eyewitness is featured who writes the report in the first person. Utnapishtim is the survivor of the flood, just like Noah in the Bible, but in the latter, the story is told in the third person. The God of the Old Testament, too, blesses his protégés and seals an eternal covenant with them and for all their descendants. And the water shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. Genesis 9, verse 15. Really, that is rather a reassuring statement, if it actually came from the mouth of God. Earth dwellers of all times should never have to fear the effects of a meteorite strike in the sea. As astronomers today are aware, such strikes are quite possible, with terrifyingly destructive consequences for all humankind. But this promise does not actually originate from the creator of the universe, from that incomprehensible intelligence of the first source. The ancient texts in the Gilgamesh epic and in the Old Testament speak of other gods. Gods? Surely the Old Testament speaks only of one God. I have already had to destroy this illusion in my previous books. The Hebrew word that stands for God in Genesis is Elohim. This is a plural word. There is no singular Elohim. What is meant is the gods. This may be a sobering thought, but it remains the truth. The Jewish, Islamic, and Christian world religions are based on the books of Genesis. Islam treats the old stories of Moses and Suleiman, as respectful traditions. The Torah scholars of the Jewish world religion have always been not only believers, but have also seen their traditions as subjects of interpretation and research, and their work can be read, for example, in the many Midrash volumes. These literary works, known as Midrashim, contain the research of many centuries of outstanding Jewish scholars. A Midrash is a work of interpretation, a search for meaning. It is only the Christian religion that constructs the Word of God out of the Old Testament texts, generally applicable and without exception reports of the consummation of a Word of God. Rahner. Now, no religion just appears. Every religion has a history, a kind of ur-religion, as humans were supposed to be able to keep to and live according to the pronouncements of their forefathers. There is no written evidence of this earliest religion. It probably took centuries for the various stories to be compressed into a story. Each of these stories will presumably contain a kernel of truth, but to designate all these stories together as the Word of God comes close to an insult to the infinite power of creation, provided, of course, that the intelligence behind creation can be insulted by such microscopic creations as humans. The traditions collected together in the Old Testament do talk of gods who were active sometime and somewhere, but they do not fit under the umbrella of an intelligent original spirit. The God of the Old Testament, in fact, creates several eternal covenants with Abraham. Genesis 13, verse 15, Genesis 15, verse 5, Genesis 15, verse 18. One really divine covenant would have been sufficient. Again and again, burnt offerings and tribute are demanded. I find it quite inexplicable that a metaphysical God should have required them. Then there is the rather unsavory story of Sodom and Gomorrah. It appears like blasphemy to attribute that event to the intelligent creative power of God. First of all, the biblical God hears that people are committing horrible sins in Sodom and Gomorrah, but he does not seem to be certain. I will go down now and see whether they have done altogether according to the cry of it, which is come unto me. Genesis 18, verse 21. God hasn't a clue. Very sad. Then God informs Abraham of what he intends to do, and Abraham begins to plead with him. This is divine? Finally, God sends two angels to Sodom to save Lot and his family from the destruction of the two cities. Genesis 19, verse 1 and following. To begin with, these angels intend to spend the night in a public place. Why do angels need to sleep? But Lot implores them not to do this and to come and rest in his house. This evidently does not suit the lustful mob of Sodom, and immediately they surround Lot's house and demand the two angels be handed over to them, that we may know them. The pressure must have been great, as Lot offers the lecherous people his two virgin daughters. Do ye to them as is good in your eyes. The Sodomites are not interested. They begin to charge Lot's house and break down the door. Now, at last, the angels intervene. With some kind of secret weapon, they smote the men that were at the door of the house with blindness, both small and great, so that they wearied themselves to find the door. Genesis 19, verse 11 and following. The situation comes dramatically to a head. The two angels pressure Lot and his family to leave the city immediately. Lot is still hesitating. The angels become forceful. They drag Lot, his wife, and two daughters out of the house. Escape for thy life. Look not behind thee, neither stay thou in all the plain. Escape to the mountain, lest thou be consumed. Genesis 19, verse 17. In spite of this urgent appeal, Lot is still complaining. Instead of fleeing to the hills, he insists on staying in the little town of Zoar because he will feel safer there. Resigned to his stubbornness, the angels declare, "Haste thee, escape thither, for I cannot do anything till thou become thither." Genesis 19, verse 22. But the Lord, the good Lord, caused fire and brimstone to rain on Sodom and Gomorrah, from the Lord out of heaven, and he overthrew those cities, and all the plain, and all the inhabitants of the cities, and that which grew upon the ground. Evidently a rather wayward brood was flourishing in the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. But should the all-knowing God not have known beforehand what was going on? And why the sudden haste, the extreme pressure? Was there a countdown running, which neither the angels nor God could stop? What kind of a God was this? My little Bible lesson is not intended to do anything more or less than make a certain observation. A God figure is described here who makes mistakes, errs, feels regret, who is capable of bloody acts of destruction and is not timeless. All of these are non-divine attributes that do not go with the perception of a being that stands above all things. It is also no use demanding a definition of God here, because the Old Testament tells the story this way and in no other. Humans are encouraged to believe that these narratives are God's word. Just in passing, the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah was not the only destruction of sinful cities. The Indian epic Mahabharata tells the same story with a few special ingredients. With chagrin, one reads about a weapon that caused the city and its entire surroundings to be burned out completely. An horrific sight presented itself. The corpses no longer looked like those of human beings. The burnt bodies had been unrecognizable. All food had become toxic, and never before had human beings seen such a terrible weapon, let alone heard of it. While the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah is described in two sentences, the account in the eighth book of the Mahabharata is more detailed. In both cases, a god was responsible for the dreadful destruction. The god of all religions? I am not so concerned with understanding the old accounts, sentence by sentence, word for word. These are concepts from a very distant past. Some god or the other, or gods, got nasty, broke off a failed experiment, or supported a preferred group of humans with their superior weapons. These gods always came from heaven or the sky. The standard assumption that our ancestors must have placed their perceived gods in the heavens because the heavens with the stars stood for the eternal or the unattainable does not stand up to any kind of critical analysis, as there were plenty of figures that came from the darkness of the underworld. The descriptions of these battles of the gods in the heavens and the behavior of those heavenly beings on earth are not explainable either poetically or psychologically. In addition to that, the descriptions are much too precise. Also, these heavenly beings spoke. They gave advice, commands, and often instructions of a technical nature. The God of the Old Testament provides excellent examples of this. He demands the sacrifice of Abraham's only son, whom thou lovest, Genesis 22. Shortly before the terrible deed can be carried out, God sends an angel from heaven to prevent this incomprehensible act. Theologians explain this contradiction as a test. God wanted to see whether Abraham would be prepared to slaughter his only son for God. He should have known this before. As a reward for this non-deed, which was only prevented by the intervention of an angel, God blesses Abraham and promises to make his descendants as numerous as the stars of the heaven and as the sand which is upon the seashore. Genesis 22, verse 17. This is a promise that, in its first phase, could only be realized by polygamy. There is plenty of polygamy in the book of Genesis. Examples, Genesis chapters 25, 29, and 34. In the second book, called Exodus, the main part is played by Moses. A man from the house of Levi had married a Levite woman who gave birth to a pretty boy child. 3 months after his birth, the mother could no longer hide the child from the Egyptians and wove a basket out of reeds, into which she laid the child. Naturally, the basket was made watertight with pitch and bitumen. One of Pharaoh's daughters pulled the basket out of the Nile and adopted the child. A touching story, which originally, however, could have taken place in India. We find the same story in the book called Adiparva of the Mahabharata. The unmarried young woman, Kunti, had been waylaid by the sun god, and the result of this unusual union was a son, who was unusually beautiful because his face shone like the sun. The former virgin, Kunti, feared the scandal, so she made a watertight casket and secretly abandoned the small child to the river. A courageous woman called Adhirata fished the casket out of the water, brought up the child as her own, and called him Karna. A third story with the very same content was literally dug up in the 19th century from the hill of Koyunik, the former Nineveh, by a Professor George Smith. British archaeologists uncovered an entire library of clay tablets that belonged to the Assyrian king Assurbanipal, and that included, among other things, the life story of King Sargon I, circa 2400 BC. He too, so the story goes, was laid in a reed basket secured with pitch and floated down the Euphrates. This strange little boat was found by a water carrier called Aki, and the little boy was finally brought up by a princess. About 1,000 years lie between the story of Sargon and the one about Moses, but just how many years lie between the story of the Indian virgin Kunti and the story of Moses, we cannot now determine. God's word? Who copied it from whom? When Moses had grown up, he watched his Hebrew brothers performing the work of slaves. He was the witness to a killing of a Hebrew by an Egyptian foreman. And he looked this way and that way, and when he saw that there was no man, he slew the Egyptian and hid him in the sand. Exodus 2, verse 12. The following day, Moses watched two Hebrews quarreling. Moses tried to mediate, but one Hebrew answered, "Who made thee a prince and a judge over us? Intendest thou to kill me as thou killedest the Egyptian?" Moses was afraid, as his murder of the day before appeared to be public knowledge. He fled to the land of Midian, took as his wife the young daughter of, allegedly, a priest, and begat his first son, Gershon, with her. No special role appears to have been intended for the latter in the Bible, as with one exception, Exodus 18, verse 2 and following, he disappears again without a trace. While Moses was tending his father-in-law's sheep, he came to the sacred mountain called Horeb and watched the strange spectacle of flames burning in a thorn bush without the bush being consumed. Curious, Moses moved closer, and to his astonishment heard a voice coming from the thorn bush. The voice commanded him to take off his shoes and step closer, as he was on holy ground. Finally, the voice told him it was the God of his forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. God tells Moses that he knows about the suffering of the Israelites who live in captivity in Egypt, and he has come down to deliver them and lead the Israelites into a beautiful, wide land in which milk and honey flowed. So far, so good, one assumes. The good Lord has ordered a murderer to lead the Israelites out of Egypt, but with God everything has a reason. He sends Moses to Pharaoh to demand the release of his countrymen, and when the latter refuses, he subjects Egypt to various plagues. "And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go, no, not by a mighty hand, and I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders." Exodus 3, verse 19 and following. Before the plaguing begins, however, God gives an order to steal from the Egyptians. The Israelites are not to leave empty-handed, but should borrow diverse pieces of jewelry and clothing in order to spoil the Egyptians. Exodus 3, verse 22, and 12, verses 35 through 37. This is exactly what is said in the Bible, and doesn't correspond at all with the commandment that God later gives to his people, "Thou shalt not steal or covet thy neighbor's property." This also shows one of the reasons why Pharaoh did not immediately allow the Israelites to go. During the further course of the story, Aaron plays the second role in these events. Who was Aaron? The Jewish Encyclopedia has the answer. Aaron was the oldest son of the Hebrew Amram of the tribe of Levi. Moses, his second son, was 3 years younger, and their mutual sister, Miriam, was a few years older. Aaron, great-grandson of High Priest Levi, followed his priestly calling within his tribe. While Moses was brought up at the Egyptian royal court, Aaron lived with relatives in the eastern borderlands of Egypt and was known as an outstanding orator. When Moses received God's command to lead the Israelites out of Egyptian captivity, he asked his brother Aaron for help. The fact was that Moses was not at all a good speaker. He required an official spokesman who would present Pharaoh with Israel's demands. During the years that followed, Through the Exodus, Aaron advanced to become Moses' deputy, and he became high priest. He enjoyed the special protection of the Lord in the pillar of cloud. Whenever problems appeared, which required technologically gifted understanding, Aaron was on the spot. He was known as a magician who could conjure up processes that looked like miracles to the masses. Once, as we read in Exodus, Aaron threw his staff to the ground in front of Pharaoh, and the staff was immediately transformed into a living serpent. When the court magician tried to duplicate the trick, Aaron's serpent devoured all the other serpents. Exodus 7, verses 10 through 12. The same magic staff was used to turn Egypt's waters into a stinking red flood.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.